very familiar with it since I spent a few months working on it, is that it takes that recommendation and fleshes it out so that, one, it's recommending that manufactured housing parks still be allowed in the residency district, but also includes certain standards in terms of density, lot size, what have you, that the manufactured housing parks would need to meet. And I'd like to just emphasize with respect to those standards that about 98% of them are mandated by the state law, and there's very little room for the town to maneuver. There's a couple areas where the planning board has recommended a few changes to clarify things. So in a nutshell, that's kind of what we have before you. There's a lot of details that perhaps can be addressed if people raise questions in the public hearing.
Good. Thank you, Steve. That was very good and very brief. I will now open a public hearing on this ordinance. We do have some ground rules. Please be briefer than the members of the planning board are under the microphone and state. That includes me. I'm talking about myself. Come to the microphone, state your name. Please try not to repeat what your neighbor has said. Is there anyone from the public who wishes to address this ordinance?
Madam Chairman,
yes.
I move that we order the planning board recommends that the town council adopt the proposed revisions to the zoning ordinance and the subdivision ordinance regarding manufactured housing parks per 19.49 zoning ordinance.
Okay, thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion?
Madam Chairman, that proposal for consideration by the town council also have with it the state laws, which track our recommendation to the council, and a memo from Steve Butler indicating the similarities or and or differences between the two.
Mm-hmm. And one other small thing. I saw recently in the paper that it was Thursday, March 15th, Mobile Home Park residents blast proposed increase in rent. It seems to me that if the purpose of this, the state's purpose in framing this this mandated legislation was to provide for affordable housing. I would just like the town council and the ordinance committee in particular to have this and to have something to be incorporated. I don't know what it would probably have to be looked at by the town attorney, but it seems to defeat the purpose if people who purchase these homes then rent the land.
Thank you. Then, you know, that defeats the purpose. So could you please pass that on to the ordinance committee for me?
Sure will.
Thank you. Any other comments? Yes.
What I've done, Madam Chairman, being new to the board and an alternate to the board, has taken the draft and simply marked it up. And I apologize, I guess, as a citizen prior to now not providing input or not getting a copy of this to you prior to the meeting. I should say that I have had background in manufactured housing communities. I've worked with firms that have made proposals to other communities and have been involved in trying to develop guidelines and worked with other professionals in developing guidelines. And there are some things here that I think are very obvious from my experience that should be addressed. First of all is the issue of a minimum development size. With three mobile homes, we could have a mobile home park on every corner in Cape Elizabeth, theoretically. It may be suggested that perhaps a five-acre minimum lot be adopted or added to the ordinance. I would assume that the residential aid district permitted uses, the issue of permitted use is a state-mandated requirement. I'm wondering why this isn't a conditional use. Under item 2, there shall be a double-pitched roof with no less than 25% slope, a minimum pitch of 2 and 12. I don't know if that's a typographical error, But if there are proposed to be shingles on the roof, the minimum normally by code is about a 4-12 pitch. And aesthetically, a 5-12 pitch affords a reasonable semblance to typical house slopes. I think that the under 3, the exterior walls shall have an appearance of traditional residential site-built walls. I don't know if this planning board wants to be more specific than that. I would suggest that it may really behoove us to do that, to define what we mean by traditional residential site-built walls, describe the materials, and set some guidelines there. The house will be anchored on a permanent, full frost-free wall foundation. I would add that that should say concrete frost wall foundation, and that the other building code in town should determine its depth and thickness. Under statement of purpose, I think in order to meet the statement of purpose that perhaps we need an item 8 above that says defines what compatible with existing neighborhood character would be. I think that's there are some very subtle issues there that need to be described and dealt with, because frankly, in my experience, what's happened is that applicants have come before the board, and these become very contentious points. And I think if we can define what we feel that is, or somehow give a future applicant an idea of what we're expecting, it would be helpful in both cases. Under I would say under residential district C permitted uses, wonder if that couldn't be also changed to conditional uses. Under the statement of purpose, it talks about the integrity of established residential neighborhoods. I think a lot of what has to do with established residential neighborhoods, that I guess in the best case, they relate somewhat to the topography, the place. Certainly the traditional New England village does that. A manufactured house, at least the 14-foot wide version, is really designed as something that will fit on an interstate highway or a state road. That's really the limitation of the 14-foot width. And the length is a fallout of the number of square feet that's necessary in the unit. So I really, again, thinking ahead, that the unit essentially does not fit in with the residential character being 14 feet wide of other residential units in town. That doesn't necessarily say that it's something that can't be made to reflect more closely the residential character. But I think that we should consider guidelines that would specifically deal with the idea of integrity of residential neighborhoods. I think your comment regarding affordability is a very important issue here. I don't know if that's an affordability in sense of a certain percentage of units guaranteed to meet the town's criteria of affordability, or whether the entire development would fall in that area, but that's certainly an important point. The essence of a mobile home park versus a manufactured housing community is that there are manufacturers across the state who need an outlet, so to speak. They need a road to put their cars on, to paraphrase it. And the real purpose of a mobile home park is to provide a sales outlet for mobile homes. In many cases, residents are restricted to only occupying a home that's manufactured by the person who's developed the mobile home park. That's not really inconsistent, I suppose, with developers who require you to have them construct a house within a subdivision. But it does have certain consideration. Mobile home parks are bought and sold like everything else, and there is a trend in the state that is occurring now, and as the new purchasers come in, and require existing residents either to upgrade their units or are forced to move out. That's something that may not be implied in this ordinance today, but it's something that we think we'll all be faced with in the future, and I think we should be careful as to how we deal with that. Um, I want to be sure, I guess, that the whole issue of lot size and distinction as to whether it's on a central sewer system or on public sewer or central subsurface disposal system is consistent with the rest of our ordinance and consistent with our comprehensive plan. There are some communities who have proposed not to provide mobile home parks in areas that require on-site subsurface disposal. Excuse me, because those sites generally tend to be more fragile, and it's inconsistent with the density that may be realized through a mobile home park. I think, in any event, the size of the excuse me, the size of the lot should be very closely tied and looked at in terms of overall net residential density. Under item 6, the overall area of the manufactured housing park shall equal at least the sum of. At least, I think, is the operative term there. I have E, F, G, and H. At least is a minimum acres of square foot for recreational areas, requirements for drainage and detention, common storage and trash areas, and at least a 25% open space within cluster development. Under unit setback requirements, within any clustered provision ordinance, there's a real advantage that can be gained through other than just typical front, rear, and side yard setbacks, such as Z-lot setbacks and zero lot line setbacks. I'm wondering if those types of planning criteria can be written into this ordinance. There's at least in a single wide manufactured house, whether it's a modular or a mobile home, there's a real distinction between one side of the unit and the other. One is called the service side and the other is called the living side. And ideally, in this climate, the living side should be oriented to the south, and that says a lot about in which way the units are laid out. And there's a real advantage to the notion of, particularly with narrow lots, to a zero lot line setback.
Tom, you know what? I wish you were with us at our workshops. I don't want to interrupt you, but the more you know are bringing out about this, the more I'm wondering what if the planning board wants to readdress this before at a workshop. What is the pleasure of the board? I don't mean to interrupt you,
Madam Chairman.
Yes.
If I might, Tom was indicating some very good planning standards and issues for our manufactured housing park ordinance. There are some issues that with the new state laws, as I understand them, and as Steve has briefed us, we are required to maintain a minimum level of ordinance requirements to in no way counterbalance the state law's intent or desire and requirement that municipalities adopt ordinances that allow manufactured housing sites within the community. I think that our ordinance tracks very well with the minimum and maximum allowed standards that we can impose on manufactured housing. Mm-hmm. But Tom is raising some extremely good issues. We also have a timeline and time frame issue. Tom, we've been working on this for a few months. You raised some good standards. I would propose the following. One is that we go ahead with a vote tonight and submit it to the council. Council still has to go through an ordinance adoption process, and that with that council package, with the existing state law and the memo that Steve Butler has written to us and will write to the council that deals with what we can do and can't do for the manufactured housing law. Mm-hmm. We're tightly constrained about what we can write into it, and that when we felt those restraints, we talked about some of the issues, Tom, that you've raised additional good issues. Mm-hmm. I would encourage
Excellent.
Tom to respond directly to the council in its ordinance provisions and maybe come back to the next planning board meeting when you have that new state law and any proposed revisions to it that we can then pass on to the council or that Tom can do directly to the council ordinance committee.
Would you be willing to do
that? Yes, I would.
Excellent suggestions.
Again, I understand coming into the process this late, it's very difficult, and there are things, obviously, that have happened that I don't understand through the process. I guess if I could have a closing comment, it would be that generally we have a number of standards here that aren't supported with any documentation in terms of graphics, which I think are very helpful for us and for the general public to understand the intent of the ordinance, and very helpful to potential applicants as well. And I would also propose as part of this process that we develop, just as we have with street standards in the subdivision ordinance, something similar to that for the manufactured housing ordinance.
Excellent suggestion. So do we hear a motion?
I think I made
or
the motion.
Did you make it?
Yeah, I would move the question.
Did someone second it? You, Ivan seconded it. Any other questions or comments? Hearing none, all in favor, raise your hand. Opposed? It's unanimous. Okay, we're sorry we're running late. Next thing on the agenda, Stonegate Phase 4, a 22-lot major subdivision. We will first address the preliminary plan review and have a public hearing. Mr. Taylor, would you care to very briefly explain to any members of the public here what you are proposing in this Stonegate 4?
Madam Chairman?
Yes.
Before we even get started, even as a non-voting member on this issue, I'm going to refrain from any discussion due to a conflict of interest.
Okay, thank you. In that case, Tom, would you please vote?
Okay.
Oh, you're... Oh, I see. Oh, excuse me. That's right. You don't become a voting member until the election. Excuse me, folks. I'm a little mixed up. Sorry, Tom.
Good evening.
Good evening.
My name is Bob Taylor, and I am with Stonegate Associates, the applicant for this subdivision. In view of the time, we propose to make a very brief presentation and to make as much time available for public comments as possible. And then after that, comments by the board. We have the members of the development team here and would certainly be willing to stay and respond this evening, but I suggest that time might force us to either responding in writing or responding at a follow-up meeting. But we'll let that be at the pleasure of the board. As you're aware, we are the owners of two subdivisions in Cape Elizabeth, one called Stonegate and one called Dyer Pond. And these subdivisions are located on a 245-acre parcel of land between Mitchell Road and Shore Road, with the northeasterly corner of our project quite close to Fort Williams. All but 80 acres of this 245 acres has come under the purview of the board in prior applications, one for 52 lots for Stonegate Phases 1, 2, and 3, and one for 8 lots for Dyer Pond. We are presenting here an application for 69 of the remaining 80 acres. Of the 11 acres that are not addressed, we are simply proposing that they be granted to the town as conservation land. Within the 69 acres that we have under consideration here this evening, we are proposing that 31 acres be open space and conservation land, and that 38 acres be developed into building lots and roads serving those building lots. We are proposing a total of 22 lots. These lots are all proposed for sale to others, would be served by public streets with public water and underground cable utilities, are currently proposed to be served by septic systems for sewage treatment. We do intend to propose a sewer extension to the town council, but it is unclear whether such an extension would be allowed or granted, so that we have submitted full data on septic systems required. Our basic approach is that the site consists of a large peninsula of upland surrounded on three sides by wetland, and we have formatted our lots in a cluster configuration on the large peninsula of upland. As a part of our overall project plan, clear this is to the board and to the camera, but the area crosshatched in green is the area that is either now or will be conservation land as a part of the overall development. The links shown in orange are the pedestrian access that, while pedestrian access is allowed, of course, across the entire green-shaded area, the orange links represent existing trails or trails that might be developed and represent the general pattern of circulation. That's a very brief presentation of a particularly complex proposal.
Thank you.
Unless there are questions, I would suggest we open it to the public.
Thank you. We do have a few ground rules. Please come to the microphone, state your name, try not to repeat what your neighbor has said, and try to be a little briefer than we are, okay? We'll now open the public hearing. Is anyone from the public here wishing to address this? Yes.
My name is William Gatchell, and I live at 10 Belfield Road.
Good evening.
And good evening. Appreciate the opportunity to briefly comment. I would like to know if you are in possession of a letter dated March 1, 1990, from Stonegate Associates to Mr. Charles Kellogg and the Cape Elizabeth Town Planning Board. In that letter are references of letters and or conversations with Mr. Taylor and Stonegate Associates. Some concerns that my wife or I have had or expressed, and Mr. Taylor has very nicely summarized most of those, I think, very effectively in his comments in his letter. My request is that the Planning Board please keep those items that have been addressed in mind. Most of them appear that they will probably not be of concern. However, as data, as I understand it, is more articulately developed in the planning process, there may be some changes, and we would appreciate it very much if the Planning Board would not lose sight of those items. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gatchell. Anyone else from the public? Last chance. Well, I will close the public hearing on the preliminary plan. Any questions by members of the Planning Board? Yes, Tom.
With regard to the road circulation, I assume that the loop is created in order to provide, because you would have a cul-de-sac longer than the town permits.
That's correct.
May I just ask, are there any other alternatives? It seems as though you've got quite an extensive length of road there. Are there intermediate cul-de-sacs that might work, or some other alternative rather than having...
We looked at two alternatives that were different in basic concept than this. There are always small modifications of any alternative. But one is to connect through to Shore Road. And we found that we would be creating 1,500 or 1,700 feet of additional road, serving no more lots, and creating an additional wetlands crossing. And so we discarded that as both uneconomic and greater environmental impact. The other alternative was to come in on the entrance shown and to loop around and exit out on a part of Lot 49, which is a part of existing Stonegate subdivision. And that has approximately the same length of road and has another major wetland crossing. So while it was economically equivalent, there was more wetlands impact, so we selected this alternative.
I guess I would address my next question to Steve Butler. Steve, does the Would the ordinance permit them, say, coming in and rather than doing a full loop to come into that sort of island area with a cul-de-sac and then somewhere along the longer cul-de-sac that goes to the very back of the property have another intermediate cul-de-sac or turnaround or some other way for emergency vehicles to get by one another or to get by an obstacle rather than having to have a complete loop in the middle of the property?
There may be a way. I don't think the ordinance per se requires a loop. However, at some what happens is you start measuring the dead end, you know, the distance of the dead end aspects of the road from the point where the Esplanade ends.
Yeah.
And so whatever could be worked out, and depending upon site constraints, I mean, however it was done, once it reaches 1,000 feet, the applicant would be constrained. So I'm not sure. I mean, so the measurement would be from that point, not from a second cul-de-sac or what have you down the road.
The measurement would continue from some intermediate measure in order to allow, you know, have a bypass or an intermediate cul-de-sac of some sort, or a turnabout.
If I may suggest something, it would be possible to continue the Esplanade construction to some point farther up this way, so that we are now 1,000 feet or less from the end of this cul-de-sac. This would require a waiver of the board's 500-foot limit, but it is allowed, and would result in the elimination of one wetland crossing and the shortening of this road, which would be reconfigured to serve the same number of lots, but would be probably about the distance between my fingers rather than this way. And we were hesitant to ask for a waiver because the new
subdivision ordinance is something that hasn't been tested and we haven't had a lot of experience with it. If there is, we would be happy to study that and present the alternative at the next meeting, and perhaps other members of the board might comment this evening to give us some assistance in that regard.
I would like to remind the board that we did go to the site, but quite informally, and I would suggest that before the evening is over, the board set time for a formal site walk. When would you like to go? And Steve will set that up. When would it be convenient for you?
Any period other than the 18th through 20th of April, when my parents have been kind enough to invite my family and I down to Florida to get some sunshine.
Well, that's just so tough to take, Mr. Taylor. Well, I guess.
Might I suggest that that probably sometime a couple of weeks from now is better than this weekend because we need time to lay out the road in the field. We have now just located the key points, but I think it would be appropriate for the board to be able to reference the road construction plan and stations along it as we were walking the site so that they knew exactly where we were. I've spoken with the surveyor, and they could be ready for us on the weekend of March 31, April 1, and Saturday. So I would suggest either Saturday, March 31, Saturday, April 7, or Saturday, April 14.
April 14th is Easter Saturday, you say?
Yes, it is.
Well, you wouldn't want to do that. And isn't it Passover, too, at that time?
That's during the week. That's April 10th.
Oh. 9th.
April 7th?
April 7th, all right with the board? All right with you, Mr. Taylor?
Certainly.
Okay. How about April 7th? What time? 10? 9?
10.
10. 10. I guess it's at 10.
Got to get the chores done first.
So at 10 a.m., April 7th, there will be a site walk. Where will you meet? Is it going to be by that little sewer shed again?
Right here is a small wooden building that houses the sewage pumping station, the sewer stone gate. And I think we should meet there. And I would caution you not to drive onto this road where there is some gravel because it's soft and might get stuck.
That's not a good sign, Mr. Taylor.
It's part of the situation where you have a newly constructed, partially constructed road in an era when the frost is, in a time of the year when frost is coming out of the ground. I myself was stuck there this week.
Any other questions about the Esplanade, about drainage?
Madam Chairman, yes. Just on the Esplanade, I've been talking with the town engineer on a few occasions. I think, as I mentioned one or two meetings ago, the town staff expressed a preference for perhaps more traditional two-access point roadway, but I think they're willing to deal with this. The Public Works Director has some concerns about snow removal and maintenance, but again, I think those can be dealt with. Town engineer also mentioned some concerns about the Esplanade concept, which I think he's going to want to explore in more detail. And I wasn't clear in terms of whether or not they were more maintenance-related in nature or if they were more engineering in nature. So I just want to raise that to the board's attention if they want. I asked the town engineer to prepare something in memo form for the next time this comes up.
Mm-hmm. Any questions about public access? Anything at all? No questions? Then what are the wishes of the board on this preliminary plan review? You do have 30 days after a public hearing.
Madam Chairman, I would move to table that until our next meeting.
Okay. Is there a second? Is there a second to that? Judith seconds. It is getting late, and we're very tired. Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor, please raise your right hand. Opposed? Okay, we will move on now. Mr. Taylor, could you please explain to the public what wetlands you plan to alter?
We are proposing wetlands alterations in three locations. The first is in the creation of an intersection between the existing road and the proposed new road, and the creation of the proposed new road, it's all in one area, where we will be filling approximately 5,500 square feet of wetland. The second is in the area between lot one of phase four and the existing turnaround on the existing gate ledge road, where we propose to cross a narrow piece of wetland with a sewer service for lot one. It's approximately 44 cubic yards of fill to be removed and replaced, and the ground will be restored to its existing configuration. The third proposal is this wetland crossing up here, where just northerly of the intersection of Quartz Knob Road with Greystone Road, where approximately 10,600 square feet of wetlands would be filled in an area that is wooded swamp of high gradient and is substantially different in its conformation than the central wetlands of the site that tend to be flatter and wetter. We also come close to wetlands with roadway construction at two locations. Here, about 150 feet into Rockwood Road, and right opposite Rockwood Road on Greystone Road. And we have taken some care to keep our construction out of the wetlands in this area, but it will require special attention to our wetlands protection and erosion control measures during the construction period. Additionally, with regard to wetlands impacts, we have held the project boundary back from the wetlands edge in general. And in specific, are proposing that that there be a buffer area within 100 feet of every wetland where construction could only take place in accordance with the Department of Environmental Protection's permit by rule regulations. Essentially, this requires that the construction be set back a minimum of 25 feet from the wetland, greater if the topography slopes towards the wetland, and that appropriate measures be taken in terms of minimizing siltation and runoff and impacts outside the alteration area. That summarizes, I believe, the wetlands impacts. We think that the plan as a whole is quite sensitive to wetlands issues, and we think that by offering much of the area on the plan to the town as a conservation land, similar to what we did at Stonegate, we will be enhancing the protection of the remaining wetlands. We have here an area of probably 22 or so acres that are wetlands or wetland soils.
Thank you, Mr. Taylor. Anyone from the public care to comment on Mr. Taylor's proposal to alter the wetlands? Seeing no one, hearing no one, I will close the public hearing. And anyone on the planning board with some questions? Ivan?
I think that the site walk will be very important. It's one thing to look at plans and the way they're outlined, but I think when we get a chance to take a walk on the site and can view the topography ourselves, I think we'll be able to draw some better judgments on the application for wetlands alteration. So I'm leaning in the direction of making this tabling in tandem with the preliminary plan, just so that we have the time to consider both.
Mm-hmm.
Not ready to make that motion. If other people have other things to say, that's fine.
Anybody else have anything, any questions at this particular point? Oh, Judith.
Bob, could you explain again? I apologize for zoning out for about 4 seconds there while you were explaining the wetlands. Going up Greystone Road and you take a right, the first kind of dirt road right in there.
We have constructed as a part of our Stonegate mm-hmm. subdivision a road currently called Greystone Road and only partially complete that comes in basically along the alignment of the proposed road and sweeps to the right as my pencil. When we construct, actually widen that road and extend it, serve mm-hmm. this, we will be impacting wetlands in two places. One, on the left-hand side as you're going in the immediate vicinity of the property line between the existing Stonegate property and the Stonegate Phase 4 property. And secondly, in the area of the intersection on this side, the southerly side, where we will be flaring road construction to allow vehicles to turn to the right as part of that intersection.
Okay. That's not what I understood at all. I'm glad I asked.
If no one has any questions, I notice Mr. Murphy is here. Is anyone interested in addressing the traffic is always a problem on Mitchell Road. Is anyone interested in asking any questions at this point in time about traffic? If there aren't any questions about traffic, I would just like to caution, I think it has something to do not only with the wetlands alteration, but the preliminary plan as well. I, too, have a high regard for the honesty that you have displayed in the past. I will never forget when you came before this board and told us that you had discovered more wetlands. I was very impressed. And I think you are very sensitive to our greenbelt. However, I would just like to caution the planning board before I leave that I was very opposed to the Dyer Pond Road, not the subdivision. I made no secret about it. I fought till the very end. I continue to fight. I continue to fight because this is one huge contiguous parcel. It's all the same subdivision from Stonegate to Dyer Pond, now to Stonegate 4. This one huge contiguous parcel is essentially a watershed of over 100 acres. And the water from Oakhurst and, well, from many adjacent subdivisions empties there into the ponds, into the brook, and then out to the big Atlantic Ocean. So I would caution you and remind the planning board that there is an E.C. Jordan report on this entire thing. And much of the flow, my concern is for flooding of Dyer Pond Road, which in itself is a huge dead end. And if people begin to live there, I'd hate to see them cut off because we're flooded. If, according to your engineering reports, the weirs that you are going to install, if the culverts that I hope are installed under Dyer Pond Road do not work, and engineering has been known not to work, since all of your drainage calculations are based not on the 100-year flood, but the 25-year flood, then we are all going to be in very big trouble, and Shore Road will flood. So during this process, I would hope that the planning board would be very sensitive to the E.C. Jordan report and what could happen concerning flooding in that whole area and poor drainage. And the last thing that I would like to say is many things have been begun in this contiguous parcel, but many things are not finished. Dyer Pond Road was begun months ago. The riprap is still there. I would like to know, here you are before us with a new plan. When are you going to finish the other stuff? And how long will the people of Cape Elizabeth have to look at the riprap and the war zone that has been created there down on Shore Road? In addition, as I recall, a pedestrian, I guess it was path, was supposed to be cleared from Mitchell Road to Fort Williams. And that was way back in Stonegate. And you assured us one time when you came before us, I think it was for a re-subdivision issue, and I asked you that, you assured us that that would be done. And I have not seen the clearing of that. So it is my belief that before we start ripping up more, why can't we finish what we have begun? So that's what I have to say about it. Anyone else on this? Steve, did you have something?
Madam Chairman, I think there are a lot of issues that are still out there. I think several factors that relate to some of the silence this evening. One is this lateness of the hour. I think also given the fact that there'll be many more comments, I think, after the site walk, and so I think the next meeting will be many more substantive issues to be raised and discussed. And third, I think that since the applicant is proposing a lot of the final details to be delayed until the final plan stage of the planning process, I think that there may be many issues that right now don't seem to be crucial that will come up during the final plan stage and will need to be addressed by the planning board. So I think this is unusual in terms of a major subdivision that a lot of the details are being left to the final plan. I think as long as the board and the applicant both understand that, we can proceed ahead in a good direction.
Anything else, Dick?
Madam Chairman, yes? Also at our last workshop meeting, we set as one of our goals for this coming year to have that workshop meeting to be devoted to principally a planning issue, and also because of the heavy workload that we're facing, do something with applications as well, to spend an hour at our workshop session, not to vote, but only to discuss around the table that particular application. I'm not sure when our workshop session is for April.
April 3rd.
I think it would be, I'll raise it to the board whether it would be appropriate to have Stonegate 4 for an hour at our workshop session to deal just, Marion, with the issues that we're talking mm-hmm. about as far as wetlands and for the preliminary plan review, mm-hmm. to talk about some of the things that Tom and others have raised as issues of mm-hmm. concern for the subdivision, and then going out in the field and walking through and looking specifically at the road areas, and then coming into our next meeting and being able to deal with it more effectively.
Mm-hmm.
A lot, as Ivan has suggested, is going to depend on what we see in the field and getting our feet wet or not as we walk mm-hmm. through the wetlands in the conservation area, and then testing the E.C. Jordan reports on that basis. So I really want to get out there and swamp yep. around.
Okay. Do I hear a motion?
I have a motion that we table the wetlands application at this point in time.
Good. Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor, raise your hand. Opposed? It is again unanimous. I'm afraid that it is now 20 after 10. We are backed up. There are 8 people waiting in the wings, not tonight, but I see one gentleman waiting in the wings in the back. Does the board wish to waive its rules and accept this applicant?
Yes, ma'am. I would move that we waive our rules, and it seems we do it every meeting. We are getting backed up quite a bit on applications. And it's really through no fault of the applicant, but more of our process with
yes.
applications that are before us. It is an application completeness review tonight.
Yes.
And I would think that we could deal with that fairly quickly.
Agreed. Is there a second?
Seconded.
Any discussion? All in favor, raise your hand. Opposed? It's unanimous. I have a...
Yes? Madam Chairman, just in terms of Stonegate Phase 4, I wanted to see if the board just... in terms of housekeeping, want to either include the permit for construction and resource protection district, also to table that issue so it all could be heard concurrently.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing with amendment.
And the amendment, we have floated that along in our other subdivisions.
Right.
So
really goes
I would assume that C and D can just be
so moved.
Carried along. Second?
Second.
All in favor, raise your hand. Opposed?
Chairman, well, just quickly, April 3rd workshop meeting.
Yeah.
We invite Stonegate 4 into that session with the board's concurrence. Spend not more than an hour reviewing the subdivision's proposal and going on to other planning matters.
Mm-hmm. Sounds good. Well, we thank you very much, Mr. Taylor. And next time, there probably won't be any public hearings, and the planning board can give you much more attention.
Thank you.
On the next new business, Spurwink Woods off Chevres Road, I am going to step down and ask that Steve Etzel vote. Oh, Ivan, right. And Ivan will take over the meeting because I have the appearance of a conflict.
Welcome back, Mr. Drinan. Could you identify yourself for the board?
Thank you, Mr. Mose. My name is Ed Drinan.
This is an application completeness test. We are late in the process here, which is not your problem, it's ours. I would appreciate it if we could hold this effort to around 10 minutes so we could...
I'll hold it to 5 minutes.
That'd be great. Okay, yes. So Steve Etzel, I'd like to appoint you as voting member on this one. Thank you.
I appreciate you seeing us tonight. I know you've had a hectic evening. As a matter of a quick matter of housekeeping before I start, if you would please look at the booklet which I have submitted and turn to page 3. Halfway down that first paragraph of page 3, there is a sentence that reads, "This is a low-density subdivision calling for 17 to 19 lots on a parcel whose net residential density allows," if you would kindly pencil in 45 to 50, and then it continues, "housing units and so forth." That was a oversight by somebody else, of course. Thank you very much. Briefly, Spurwink Woods was discussed in a preliminary way before you last year during October and November. It concerns the development of a piece of land with which you are familiar into single-family house lots. The primary focus of our discussions at that time was on road access. The plan before you now is centered on a 17 to 19 lot single family subdivision whose focus will be on waste disposal, a common septic system or public sewer. And with that, I'll ask the board's pleasure right now regarding a review of the application completeness checklist. Do you want me to comment on the items, most of which are marked okay, that is complete? Would you like to me to just comment on those two items which are listed by the planner as partial?
I would ask Mr. Butler just to go down through the application completeness on the items that are marked partial and comment on his review.
Okay, and Mr. Dryden and I have talked about these, so he's aware of them. On 8A, there's a partial under public sewer facilities, and the reason why that's in there, and actually probably should be a blank, Mr. Dryden is proposing to submit, in essence, two variations of the same plan. One subdivision which would have proposed to have 17 lots to be served by a by subsurface disposal, septic systems, commonly clustered. And the other variation would be a 19-lot subdivision that would be served by public sewer if the public sewer ordinance could be used in a way to provide that sort of service. Given the fact that at least that I understood Mr. Dryden wanting to kind of pursue both variations at the same time, I reviewed it that way, and that's the partial or the blank would be the fact that the information on public sewer line locations, dimensions, things of this nature, aren't in the current proposal. So that's 8A. Going on to 18, this is a relatively minor point. The question just would be, what other natural features are there on the site that should be preserved? The applicant's done a good job of showing where the wetlands are, shows some of the wooded areas, doesn't get to the point of identifying specific trees or clusters of trees, things of this nature, wildlife habitat areas. Just something that may be complete, may not be, something that should be flagged for the board and for the applicant. Last item is 24, the community impact analysis. Not provided at this point. I think the applicant's waiting for the board to let him know whether or not such an analysis is desired. And that's it. So I guess 18A, if the applicant wants to go ahead with the kind of concurrent proposal idea, then that would still be a partial at best. 18, I think, something the board can react to, and 24, same sort of thing.
Could you comment on those?
Yes, I'd like to comment in their reverse order. Number 24, community impact analysis, traffic study has been submitted, wetland study has been completed but not submitted. Be happy to bring it over tomorrow for our next day, so it's here for your consideration next meeting. And all those other things that are listed there are what I put under the may request category rather than the must furnish category for application completeness. I'm happy to furnish anything that you'd like to see that falls under the category of community impact analysis. All you have to do is ask for it.
Excuse me, Mr.
Yes.
Mr. Edsel.
Can't tell whether I'm turned on or not. I reviewed the traffic impact report, and I might suggest the next time we meet that either Mr. Bray is in attendance or my general impression is that there is a lot of disjointed information in here, and it's never brought together. I think it's a real key issue that either his report is more in detail and less disjointed, or he is here willing to further explain that. I think the issue of the septic common septic area, again, reviewed some of that. Again, if you have a consultant that could be here, we're looking at pumping 2 million gallons of effluent into the ground in three leach fields. I've got a lot of questions about how this has worked historically in other areas.
Yes, be happy to do both of those things at the next meeting. Any further comment on item 24 by the board?
I just had one. I don't know whether it comes under the community impact, but if Mr. Bray is going to be here, and we'd like to discuss traffic impacts on Mitchell Road, some of the feeder roads, and how that affects this.
Yeah, I've asked him to look into, of course, not only the impact from my proposal, but from others that are ongoing before you and have already been approved. He'll be prepared to discuss that.
Yeah, that's good. And I don't know whether impact on schools would be another.
Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't hear you say schools.
Impact on schools would be considered under community impact.
Okay.
School population.
Yes.
Mr. Chairman?
Yeah.
I'm confused, and it's late, and I get confused late on, Ed. You're looking for some planning board input on what you should be doing for community impact analysis? I mean, that's your question?
Yes.
We have a list, though. We have items that are required.
Yes, you do, and those are items that you may require of the applicant, but not items that I consider that to be must done for application completeness.
Mr. Chairman, just to clarify, I think the applicant's correct in that the community impact analysis is optional on the board's part, but I guess I've always read this to mean that if the board wanted to have a community impact analysis, that everything would be provided, unless the board indicated otherwise.
Well, I would think so. Issues like estimated impact on wildlife habitat areas, impact of stated goals, objectives, comprehensive plan. I can see number 9, any other study deemed appropriate by the board.
That's certainly a choice issue.
Certainly a choice issue, but I would think that you'd want to go right down 1 through 8 and deal with each of those issues. And in some issues, there is not a significant impact, and a statement to that effect would be appropriate.
Sure.
Also 8, 1 through 4.
As well as demographic description, yes. In terms of any other study deemed appropriate by the board, I'm not aware of any peculiarities of the site that are significant issues, only because I haven't been on a sidewalk for this property. I remember that there was a stand of trees that we preserved in an adjacent subdivision, and that was a pretty important issue for that adjacent subdivision approval process. I don't know how those trees relate to your property and whether or not there are significant trees there, but there may be some vegetative issues that we may want to see. And I guess I won't know that as one member until I've seen the site, walked the site. So in terms of that issue, if there are other studies that deal with community impact analysis, and if that's deemed one of them, that may have to occur. But we really won't know that until we visit the site.
I agree, and I thought that might come under the preservation of natural features, number 18 on the checklist, and we're prepared to address that. And primarily, the preservation of natural features has been, addressed very nicely with the layout of the road, very specific. It's skirted ledge outcroppings and significant tree growth, and following the outline of the road, a specific lot layout with proposed building windows for houses that some are close to the road, some are further back from the road, so that we do take care of, as I hope you will agree on your sidewalk, an outstanding piece of land. And as we go along on the sidewalk, if you see something that you would like to see preserved or maintained, we'll work together and take care of that. The only other item on the checklist, back to 8A, as I said, I'd work in reverse, is the public sewer, which I don't expect that we'll get into in very much depth here right now, issue. However, I'd like to say that I've submitted my position regarding what I believe is my right and entitlement to having the site sewered by public sewer. I think I've also demonstrated adequate plant capacity by the treatment facility. And I further stated my opinion of your authority to rule on the issue. You know where I stand. You know where I think the ordinance stands, but I'd like to know at some point is your position.
Mr. Chairman,
yes.
philosophically, and I think that's all we can do at this point until we get into some of the technical issues. This planning board has said to the council in a workshop session, and to the sewer board, I believe, and it was about a year ago, that it was related to another subdivision that was immediately adjacent to your residence, as a matter of fact, where the issue was raised with the council, that it makes little sense for this town to be approving subdivisions on on-site septic systems where you bring in a proposal, or an applicant brings in a proposal to the planning board, and it is approvable as a subdivision based on on-site subsurface waste disposal systems when there's adequate capacity in our sewer system to take and treat those wastes. Most of us understand the issues that this town went through in the southern sewer system and the resulting compromises that occurred in our ordinances. We suggested to the council at that workshop session that they consider amending that policy issue that found its way into language, and amended that by allowing sewer hookups for any lots that are otherwise approvable as subsurface lots, thereby not increasing the density of development in the community because it's approvable anyway, and only serving better from a public standpoint the waste stream of the of those lots. Where the council has gone since then is unknown. They've had a number of other issues that they've been dealing with. We have now two subdivisions where it may be appropriate to raise that issue again as a planning board for them. We're not opposed to what you're suggesting. We are not the appropriate party to make those decisions. We're recommenders and approvers within the guidelines of our ordinances. Our ordinances are handed to us by the council. We can only suggest policy changes.
This is clearly not an issue that the planning board, as Dick has said, can vote on, but we certainly can express our opinion to the town.
I'll look forward to discussing it with you at some point in the process.
So you won't get a decision from us, so to speak. The decision has to come from a higher body.
Mr. Chairman, I'd just like to indicate to the applicant that I'd like to see him pursue as far as you can the possibility of public sewer. I think Dick mentioned a number of the issues and some of our limitations. I have a real difficulty with the common sewer.
I do too.
Area, and I think this is a case where public sewer is clearly a preferred alternative. I'd just like to see you pursue that however you can.
It's in an area of town that is surrounded with existing neighborhoods, all of which are on public sewer. One step to further my desire to obtain public sewer and still stay within the town of Cape Elizabeth is for you to say tonight we're going to deny you public sewer on this site and seek your recourse elsewhere. That would be a step for me to take in the right direction. I don't know if you'd care to do that or not.
Mr. Chairman, we have no ability to do that. You do not have any right for public sewer other than what's provided by ordinance. In this town, this planning board cannot otherwise grant or deny you the rights to those sewers. This is not the board to do it.
It's not within our purview.
The ordinance is clear.
I'll accept that opinion.
Are there any other comments on the application completeness issue? Does the board have any additional comments? hearing none, I think that you know what we need in terms of making this complete. The next step basically is for you to come before us with these issues settled, and we can consider it as a preliminary plan process.
I see. I thought that there was a chance that you may, based upon the information submitted, consider it complete with those others to be an option which you would demand of me tonight.
What is the pleasure of the board? Deem this complete with the understanding that these items will be taken care of, or we can wait and review what comes before us at the next meeting. The two choices.
Mr. Chairman, the substantive issue is the community impact analysis. the other pieces of data are partial, and I don't see anything to hold up completion review other than number 24. Would that be correct, Steve, from your standpoint as well?
I think 18, that would be correct. 8A raises a question in terms of how far the board wants to go with that. If the board, you know, and if the applicants at some point gets the approval for public sewer service and the board hasn't determined completeness on that item, it might mean that... If the board wanted to grant completeness or on that issue, it would really have to be for the private septic system proposal only, because other information clearly isn't there.
I think that's the only one we can consider at this point in time.
I understand that based upon your comments of tonight. I'd like to point out, though, that in the review of the application with Steve, and correct me, Steve, if I'm incorrect, regarding item 24, the planning board may require the applicant to conduct this. Now, I don't know if you'd normally establish a requirement for those items which may be required at this time, or I was under the impression after conferring with Steve for the last 2 months that I've been waiting to come before you that these were optional things which you would require following your acceptance of the completeness of the checklist.
Just to clarify that, that was not the message I was trying to get across. I think what the applicant was saying was, can I go ahead and ask the board if they want the community impact analysis later? I said, sure, that's fine, that's your right. I didn't understand you didn't think that that was going to be, that if the board wanted it, that would slow down completeness. I mean, that would be my understanding, that if the board thinks it's necessary, you need to put it in, and you need to prepare it before you can have completeness. And so that's board decision, I guess that was my understanding all along, and that obviously didn't get across when we talked.
Well, lacking the community impact analysis, I think we are incomplete on that item. And what is the pleasure of the board?
I would like to see the community impact statement before completion. The other two items I don't have any trouble with.
Anybody else?
I don't know how to do it. It's subject to them bringing it in. It just seems like you should have it first.
Do we have a motion that we can make at this point?
Where's that?
Let me draw your attention to the last page.
Be it ordered that the preliminary plan application for Spurwink Woods, a 17 to 19 lot major subdivision located off Service Road and Spurwink Avenue and proposed by Edward Drynan, is deemed to be incomplete in accordance with Section 16-2-4 of the subdivision ordinance and the facts presented.
And if I could add to that, do I have a second?
Second.
If I think we should be specific in this, because we do not want Mr. Drynan to be coming back and forth. Yeah. I think you understand what items we indicated as being partial. I think the major item that's missing is item number 24.
Yes.
Clear on that item.
And Mr. Chairman, there is then the question, too, the whole issue of the public sewer versus on-site and the adequacy of the information for an on-site versus a public sewer issue. While we may stand with Mr. Drynan and recommend to the council, we are only authorized to do certain things. We will need soils data. We will need to have adequate and sufficient information to allow on-site wastewater disposal on that.
I don't think there's any choice. It has to go with the on-site at this point in time. That's where the application has to be, unless you can get the town council to change their mind.
All right. since the issue was just raised again by Dick, I would really like to just read one section of the ordinance sewer under sewer extensions. It's the only section that applies to to raw land without existing houses on it. It's therefore the only section of the Sioux Ordinance under which I can petition any body of the town. And the only organization of the town mentioned in that sewer extension section is the Planning Board. And it says that if the Planning Board denies me, then I'm off to the Sewer Appeals Board. And it would be helpful, as I said a few minutes ago, in my process for you to, maybe you did deny my request to sewer this site.
Mr. Chairman, Madam Chairman is somewhere else. There she is.
I was unclear about that.
That's not a denial. If we deny an application for a preliminary plan approval, you'll have a denial for the use of public sewers. This issue was raised in another subdivision, again, next to your house. We did not deny that. We tried to get it sewered. In fact, we approved the subdivision subject to planning the council allowing that sewerage to exist. And let me say, though, again, that the item that the fix to that issue that this planning board in workshop session has recommended to the council is not for a blanket change to the sewage policy of the town. It is wherever there are lots that are otherwise acceptable for on-site subsurface waste disposal, then those lots should be allowed to be sewered by public sewer. So the burden of proof is first, are those lots allowed to be, and that's not policy, that's just what the planning board has recommended. Are those lots allowed under our existing ordinances to be built on with subsurface waste disposal on site?
I understand what you're saying, and I understand what I have to do here. Now, we're prepared to go both routes, and I certainly hope we'll demonstrate adequate on-site subsurface disposal. Not the best system in the world, but technically adequate, and the town engineer, I think, will approve it, as will the town plumbing inspector. That's my full expectation, and once that is demonstrated, we'll see where the sewer issue goes from there. And I'll look forward to seeing you next month with my completed checklist.
We've had the motion made and seconded. I don't think we voted on this issue. There's a motion before the board at this point in time to deny application completeness. Any further discussion?
Just one question. Yes. Have we made a clear recommendation to the applicant as to what it takes to be complete?
Yes, in writing.
Okay.
To receive a note in writing indicating what items are lacking at this point in time. I just signed that.
Except that's data receipt. I think we'll get something writing, but I think it's clear that it's item 24, the community impact analysis.
Yeah.
All those in favor? Opposed? The motion is denied on unanimous.
Thanks for extending your time period to hear us tonight.
And I'll turn the meeting back over to Mary Guthrie.
Okay. Under other business, I'm sorry that we're running so late. I have to bring up to you a question on something that happened last month. Mr. Higgins, if you recall, off of Wood Road, applied for a public access waiver. The record will show from the minutes of last month that we must have been very tired. We mandated, but that was suggested from reports, that Mr. Higgins build a 22-foot driveway. Unfortunately, as I was studying my ordinances for the meeting tonight, under section 19-3-5, I find that no driveway in residence A and C shall exceed the width of 20 feet. And I think that the mix-up occurred because I think that the right-of-way has to be a minimum of 22 feet, and whoever gave us all of this information got a little mixed up, and we just went along with it. So,
Madam
yes.
Chairman, maybe
we talked about this a little bit earlier, and there is a section.
It's on page 26, is it not? Yeah. Section 19-3-5.
Yeah. Dash 5, sub C. Mm-hmm. The question, having looked at this, I didn't have a chance to talk with the code enforcement officer, the zoning ordinance. So looking at that section compared with the public action waiver provision, appears as though there is a slight discrepancy.
There's something wrong.
And the question would be, I guess the question that's raised is that when the public access waiver provision was put into the zoning ordinance, was it that anticipated that by its very nature that would be something more than a strict driveway? I mean, just because having to go through the process that it's, you know, they would have to meet the dimensions that would be required, you know, that wouldn't be required for most driveways. What I don't know is I don't have the final interpretation enforcement officer that would let us know. Something that the boards, having looked it over, it's something that's been required several times, most times for public access waivers.
Well, it's very unusual to me.
What page are you on?
I think it's on page 26. It's section 19-3-5, and it states, no, it came up when Mr. Maxwell was constructing his fish and farm market, and so someone from the public raised the issue that that driveway was in a residence, I guess it's a C district there, and that it should not exceed the width of 20 feet, and of course we felt that it wasn't a residential driveway any longer, it had become a commercial driveway. So I just had to bring this up because I couldn't go away from here leaving this,
hanging.
So what would the planning board care to do about it?
Madam Chairman, since I was one of the speakers at the last one and have since had the opportunity to discuss it with the other side of the party at the last meeting,
mm-hmm.
My point was that we shouldn't be waiving our public access waiver provisions.
Mm.
We should hold the line on their consistency. If they're internally inconsistent, however, then it makes much more sense to, in this particular application, until we can get it resolved, do what Judith Kane had suggested at the last meeting, which was to allow, and I think it was a 20-foot wide driveway to exist. If we have a standard that's a zoning standard that says it shall not be greater than 20 feet, then we shouldn't be extending that beyond that.
Right, and I mean, according to our rules, we can, if it's the month after, reconsider things. So
if a person in the majority votes to makes the motion to change it, now we'll submit.
Mm-hmm. That's right. It has to be that way, right? Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor, raise your hand. Opposed?
Yeah.
The motion is carried, and I guess, Steve, that you will have to notify Mr. Higgins.
So it's down to 20 feet.
Yeah. Okay. So we rectified that.
After a month of pressure.
Now, last but not least, do I hear from Judith King a motion to nominate Richard Tinsman and Ivan Most as co-chairs? They are our two pros here. And as a co-chairperson, Steve Etzel, as vice chairman, Steve Etzel, who is conscientious and knowledgeable. Would you so move that?
At 9 minutes of 11.
Right, you do move it.
I do move it.
Janet, would you second it? Okay, any discussion?
Madam Chairman, I've got to say one word just so you know, and then you can take any actions you deem necessary.
Mm-hmm.
Your bylaws, the Planning Board rules and regulations state that the board will elect a chairman and a vice chairman.
Mm-hmm.
And that's pretty much how it is. And so by going to the co-chairman, you're going to be invoking something that would go beyond that.
Okay, Steve. Just for your information and information on the planning board, Dick and I have discussed the way this will happen, And we recognize that it doesn't make any sense to have both of us sitting in on the whole months of activity. So, Vic, stop me if I'm going too far. We've decided that at least for the first 6 months of this time that we would split it between our 3 months at a time. And Dick would take, that's right, April, May, June, and I would take July, August, September. Basically, those months we would be responsible for. So there wouldn't be a situation where you've got two people chairing the meetings. There'd be only one person chairing the meeting.
So
I've heard, and so I don't have any personal or the professional disagree. I just wanted to raise the issue as a technical point.
So would you be willing to incorporate that into your agenda, and would you be willing to second that? All in favor of this, raise your hand.
Do we vote first?
Opposed. The motion is carried, and I wish you all well.
Thank you.
And I say goodbye.
Mary.
I'm finished. Yes.
Just on the co-chairman issue, because I know it's been an issue of some discussion by many people and as town officials in town, it should be clear that this is not a normal type of operation for this planning board, that it is the result of extraordinary events that have impacted on the planning board by a number of changes to the planning board structure, resignations, and or terms expiring. And it's clearly this issue that is before us this year, and hopefully will not be before us again for several decades.
I'm sure it won't. Well,
I'd like to say, Marion, that I know we said some things last time, but I'll just repeat them now, that your chairmanship was extraordinary. I think the work you put in on some very difficult development issues was extensive and should be appreciated by the town.
Thank you so much.
And if we can continue, we've had a very tough year with a lot of applications that have been highly controversial issues, and you've done a superb job in keeping this planning board out of trouble, into the issues, and focused throughout the now 13 months that you've chaired this group of people. And I think we owe you as a town and as a planning board thanks for your efforts over not only the last year, but as a planning board member. We are, I think, collectively sorry to see you go from the board.
Thank you.
Wish you were staying here, but also recognizing that we have some good members coming in.
I think we do, too, and I think it's very important for everyone to get involved. And, you know, those of us who stay too many years are sometimes get burned out. But I learned a great deal from all of you, and I just can't thank you enough. I think that you're the best and the brightest that Cape Elizabeth has to offer. And I'm not going to say goodbye.
And before we get gushy rather than Guthrie, thank you very much. Move adjourned.
Okay. Well, I think that you have to take up something here. I think that you have to discuss how you're going to address the backlog that's on the agenda, but you can then waive that if you want to.
You leaving?
Well, I'm finished. And now, Steve Edsel, you are now a full voting member, and Jerry, you are a full associate member as of this very moment.
Let me make a suggestion on the backlog issue, Dick, if it's all right with you. I think we have to do some planning for our agenda for next month, and I think until we have a real picture of what the extent of that backlog is, it's going to be difficult for us to really address it. So my suggestion is that, Steve, we sit down and take a look at it and see where we're at. I'd like to bring the issue back up again of somehow using the workshops. I know it's people don't like it, but you know, we do have two meetings a month, and if we're really backlogged, that's one opportunity that we could use. So I think until we've had a chance to really have the backlog enumerated for us, I don't think it's going to be difficult.
And it may be an appropriate subject for our April 3rd workshop.
It may be.
We spend some good quality time talking about the number of applicants.
That would be a good suggestion. Put the agenda and the backlog issue on the workshop.
Okay. That was good to me. I move your turn. To you, Mr. Chairman.
There's nothing more appropriate than delaying discussion of the backlog.
Just makes it more of a backlog, right?